would like to introduce Professor Prithvi Singh Kandhal, who is currently the Associate Director of the NCAT, which is National Center for Asphalt Technology, which is based in US. And NCAT, if you were to be precise, is the largest asphalt road technology center in the world. And prior to NCAT, he has served as the Chief Asphalt Road Engineer of the Pennsylvania Department of Transportation for 17 years. And he has served as a President, International Association of Asphalt Paving Technology, and also as a Chairman, American Society for Testing and Materials, International Committee on Road Paving Standards, and Chairman, U.S. Transportation Research Board Committee on Asphalt Roads. And also recently he has developed new standards for IRC, which is Indian Road Congress. And he has also got a Lifetime Achievement Award in Asphalt Road Technology from the International Association of Asphalt Paving Technologists during the annual banquet held in Austin at US. We have invited him personally here because based on the requirements that we have received from the site, wherein they wanted to learn more about the advancement in the construction technologies and how the, advancement in the construction technologies and also about the maintenance. So over to you, sir. You
Thank
can
you.
Actually highlight.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, well now we go to the last lecture of the day, which is very important, quality control, QC and quality assurance, called QCQA in bituminous road construction. We don't do it in India at all. It's high time we do that. Otherwise, you know, we will have problems, failures and those kind of things, you know, you will find out what we can do about that. And it's very much prevalent in the developed countries now. They have already adopted this thing many long time ago. And topics we are going to discuss is the introduction of quality control and quality assurance concept. What's the concept? What do you mean by quality control? What is the quality assurance? It's a concept. Then testing components of the asphalt mix like aggregate and all that. And some of that we have already discussed that in the past. We will go very quickly on those. Testing asphalt mix like composition, volumetrics, mix strength, and we have also dealt with that, so we'll quickly go over that. Testing roadway density, also we discussed that. But the main thing we are going to discuss today is the quality control by the contractor and quality assurance by the owner, which includes the PWL, which is percent within limits. How much percent of your job was within limits of the specification? We got to find that out. And how? What are the pay factor? How much to pay? So, L&T asked me, I didn't have any slide presentation on this subject, and L&T rightfully asked me to discuss QCQA. Now, many times L&T has subcontractor. So, subcontractor is the contractor and you are the owner. So subcontractor has to do the quality control and you are the owner of that project, so you have to do the quality assurance. So that's where you got to think about this whole thing. Unless we do it, you know, we won't have good quality roads in India. We just only take one sample and if it fails in bitumen content, we say the whole road is bad. Then we do a check sample until it passes, you know. That doesn't make any sense. The other thing we are doing in India, we are making up the numbers. You look at all the records of the consultant or anybody or the contractor, you don't have any failing results. It's all pencil work, you know. We just fake it. We are faking everything here. It's the high time we report the real numbers. Some will fail, it doesn't matter, it will fail. Overall quality, how we are going to find out is the topic which I am going to discuss right now. So when we construct these kind of roads, we say asphalt mix quality. What do you mean by quality? How do we define the quality? Quality is which meets or exceeds the expectation or needs of the customer. The customer can be the NHI. In your case, if you have subcontractor, then you are the customers. So the subcontractor have to satisfy or meet or exceed the expectation. So that's the quality or very Quality control is the contractor's responsibility. It is also called process control. The contractor has to have a good handle, good command on the process control. Quality assurance is the owner's responsibility, making sure the quality of a product is what it should be. He cannot go by the quality control of the contractor. He has to accept that project and making sure that the quality is okay. Now, I don't know whether the quality assurance should be done by your independent consultant or whatever. Maybe they are appropriate people to do it, you know, but they got to do it. They cannot right now. They don't do any testing at all themselves, right? They just look over the shoulder of the contractor, how the testing is being done, right? They just witness the testing.
Yeah.
That's not the way, you know. Why, if you hire a contractor inspector, if he shows failing results, then he'll be fired. He won't be on the job anymore, you know. So he has to show that everything is passes, you know. So it's the responsibility of the owner, which is, might be independent consultant or might be NHI. So testing the asphalt mix, let's say what we have to test, you know, and we already discussed that we have mixed component, which is aggregate or bitumen. So we got to test them out. We got a mixed design, so we have to test the mixed composition, which is bitumen content and gradation. We got to test the mixed volumetrics, air voids, VMA, VFB, and mechanical properties, the stability and flow. So these are the things which we have to do the testing. And again, we have seen this slide so many times that we need the bitumen and aggregate to put together the asphalt concrete. Now, testing the aggregate, which is a component of the mixture, is a part of the quality control and also part of the quality assurance. So we have to test the coarse aggregate properties. All are listed here. I don't have to repeat that. We discussed that yesterday. So we have to make sure that our aggregate meets all these requirements. Also, our fine aggregate also meets all these requirements. Our mineral filler also reaches the requirement. And we already discussed that, how do we do the testing. Testing the binder or bitumen, we got to run the viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius to find the grade. 130, we also want to run penetration, and all of them. The contractor might want to conduct all these tests because he is buying the bitumen from somebody else. Now, the assurance, for assurance, you might want to test only the important properties. It's up to you. You can test all of them if you have any doubt, or you can test some of them. Especially the viscosity and penetration are very important. So, testing the mix after it's produced, we got to run the bitumen content, and our design in the MRTS is plus minus 0.3%. We can use either a centrifuge extraction method or a ignition oven method, which was developed at the National Center for Asphalt Technology, where I worked. That's
sir,
where it
was. Sir, I have a doubt here.
Yeah.
The design is plus or minus 0.3.
Geometry formula.
I have checked it, and 10 samples I got, every sample is minus 0.3%.
That's
or less than minus 3, let's say between 0 and minus 0.3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Will it be acceptable?
No, it won't be acceptable. We'll discuss that later on in a control chart, you know, we'll discuss that. That's a good point. The point being made here is that supposing I get minus 0.3 all the time, you know, it meets the specification, but it should not be acceptable. Sometimes binder current should be up and sometimes low, because we have mix is variable. It's a variable material, you know. It's not like a steel that it will be always uniform. Then there's a sampling error and testing error, so always bitumen content will go high or low. It's very natural. But there are two methods. Right now we are using the centrifuge extraction method. Ignition oven are available in India, and I'll discuss that if somebody wants to buy that, and that's what I'm in favor of that, and I'll discuss that next. Also, we would run the gradation of the extractor aggregate. That's also a mixed composition. Now, on the left side, you see the centrifuge extraction which we use all the time. But what I have seen in many cases is that we don't make any ash correction. The solvent which is coming out, you know, in the centrifuge on the left side, that solvent has some fines in it. The fines are going in the solvent, we just throw it away. and we are weighing the aggregate to constant weight and then find the bitumen content, and we will always get higher bitumen content because ash which gone in the solvent is not accounted for. So we have to make ash correction, which in many cases we are not doing that. I don't know, are they making an ash correction here to your knowledge or? Anyway, this is very important. It can give a doubt of like 0.2, 0.3 sometime to the contractor on the positive side. What we must be doing in India is to buy ignition oven which are available here. There are two companies or three companies which are making them, Thermoline and Troxler. In this ignition oven, it's very simple. You take a sample of the hot mix. You don't have to weigh it, you know. You put that in the basket, wire basket in the oven, and you just turn the switch on, and this will go to temperature to 578 degrees Celsius, where it will ignite the bitumen. The entire bitumen will burn off, and all you will be left with just an aggregate. And the oven is automated, so it will take your weight of the specimen before and after ignition, find out, calculate the binder content, and give you a printout. A printout slip will come out, which will say you got 5.2% bitumen content. There is no technician things involved. Anybody who is even a non-technician can work on this thing, you know, here. So I am in favor of this equipment, which there right now, you know, when you have centrifuge extraction, you know, you are weighing everything, you can manipulate things, you know. If somebody is really very clever, he can manipulate, he is running it every day, so he knows that, well, the bitumen content is coming out of low, so he will just increase some number or weight or whatever. With the ignition oven, things are beyond your control. You just get a printed record, how much bitumen content you have. Takes about 30 to 40 minutes. Then we got to run the gradation, we saw that yesterday. We have to make sure that it finds the, it fulfills the MORTH, the Jobex formula. We got to compact the specimen every day. I think MORTH requires that you got to do it at least two times in a day. It requires like per I don't know, per so many tons or two are minimum per day. And we determine the bulk specific gravity, theoretical specific gravity, and all these things we discussed yesterday. These are must be done at least twice a day, maybe more if you got your tonnages more. Again, you find the stability and flow using this equipment. We already discussed that. We got to find the roadway density, measured by the nuclear gauge, but most agencies will measure by core. Permissible air voids will be 8% in our case. So just to show the density with the nuclear gauge, core. We already saw that. So the quality control is the responsibility of the contractor. In the US, they demand on every project, they demand that the contractor must develop and implement a quality control plan for inspection and testing to ensure the asphalt mix meets the specification. QC plan should indicate frequency of testing. Now in the MORTH, we always say that we have to do so many times test and all that. So obviously the contractor has to test that many times, maybe more. There's no harm in getting a higher frequency. Should also tell us that to how to keep the process under control, how to determine the process has gone out of control, and how to respond adequately to bring it back. He had to explain everything in the QC plan to the owner. But this is how I'm going to do it. You know. Frequency of testing, I've just in the example I've given what is given in the orange book, in the MORTH book. As for binders, you test one test per 1500 tons of binder. Now the contractor may want to run more of them, you know. Binder content gradation, one test per 400 tons of asphalt mix, minimum two per day. Contractor may want to do four in a day. If he is using the ignition oven, he can do four, five, six, whatever he wants, you know. whenever he thinks that things are going haywire, are going out of control, he may have to run more binder content in condition test. Mixed volumetrics again, one test per 400 tons, that's in the orange book. But the one thing which the quality control has to do is to maintain the control charts for process control. Supposing he has a binder content, so he in the middle you see the white line which might be, let's say it's a 5.3% job mix formula binder content. So the upper line will be 5.3 plus 0.3, so will be 5.6, and the line below will be 5.0. So he had to plot these points every day. If he does it like two times a day, there are 2 points. It has to be plotted every day, continuous, like a patient. When you get admitted in a hospital, somebody is running a fever. The nurse comes, you know, every 3 hours or 5 hours, 6 hours, you know, take your temperature and measures in and put a control chart. So the doctor knows, you know, how many times you have fever, how much do you have fever in the morning or in the evening or whatever. So unless you have this kind of a thing, you know, you don't have any idea how the hot mix plant is working. The question was that supposing the job mix formula is 5.3 and I am getting 5.0 all the time, well, it passes the specification, but something is wrong. The process control naturally should go up and down, you know, that's the law of the nature. If it is remained low, that means something is wrong. How can he keep low all the time? He is using his pencil or fuzzing some number or something, you know. And also he is trying to put lower bitumen content all the time. He has just, you know, which they can do it on a plant, you know. They can just use a screw or something, you know. So the benefit of the control chart, this is called control chart. You have to have control chart for bitumen content, control chart for air voids, VMA and everything, gradation also. Passing 4.75, passing 2.36, passing 75 microns. So you should have a process control chart for everything. And having everything, you can really detect the problem. Yeah, like you can find out that you are running low on the air voids. So you look at the control chart for the 75 micron. You might find that 75 micron is running very high, dust is running very high. That's why the air voids are low. So you can interrelate them and diagnose the problem. Yeah, if you have all these process control charts, it's very just a common sense. We don't do it in India. It should be a requirement. If you have a L&T as a job and you have subcontractor, you just tell subcontractor you have to maintain a control chart. That's our condition. So with the control chart, we can detect the problem earlier. If things are going up and up, and we know that it's going to go going up and up, and it's pretty soon it will be out of the upper limit. It also decrease the variability, establish the process capability, reduce price adjustment cost, because some owner will penalize you or give you bonus if things are not within the specification. But by maintaining the controlling chart, the contractor is ensuring that he won't have to pay any penalty or price adjustment. Also decrease the inspection frequency. If I see a good control chart, if I'm inspector, I may not visit that plant every day. I know everything is under control, so I don't have to. So here is a control chart for air voids. Again, you can see here the yellow lines, dotted lines are the specification, and yellow ones, the red ones are the specific limit, or the yellow ones are like warning limit, you know. When things are going out of control, then you got to take some action right away to bring it to control. So the quality, we talk about the quality control now already. So the quality control has to be done by the contractor. Now the quality assurance has to be done by the owner. Quality assurance, as is used in the US and it gets to be implemented in India very, very soon, is based upon lots. A lot is generally one day's production. Like if you got like 400 ton in a day, 400 ton will be called one lot, and then you have five sublots in a lot. Generally you have five sublots. So you got to test each sublot. So one lot is one day's production. Now, how good was my one day's production? Should I pay 100%? Should I pay 80%? Should I pay bonus? I have to decide on 5 tests, which will I conduct on 5 sublots. So I have 5 numbers for that day's production. That day's production is 1 lot. I cannot penalize thing after the job, whole job is completed. So I don't go by lot and lot. I have to go for a stratified random sampling, which is preferred in each sublot, and use random numbers from table. So this kind of gives you the idea. On the top, you have a lot. On the top, you have you don't have stratified sampling, which is on the bottom. You see, I have divided that lot into 5 equal sublots, and within each sublot, I have located the sampling location by random numbers. I cannot just walk on the project, say, okay, take sample here. In the morning, I decide, I pull out random numbers from a table and decide at what channels I am going to take the sample in sublot 1, what channels and what offset from the edge. I will decide X and Y coordinates. That decide in the morning, and then I take sample there. So the bottom one, which is stratified lot, is a better approach. In the top one, because what happened in the top one, they might be close to each other. On the right side, no sample was taken, you know, it can happen. So now we are going to judge the quality of that lot, one day's production, by analyzing all the data, and that's what we are going to discuss now. Sampling location, as I said, if you are sampling from the mix, from the trucks, you can base it on time or tonnage, again by random numbers. Sampling, or you can sample the loose mix behind the paver at a predetermined random location. And when you take cores after compaction, again you take the check the density, take the core at a random location. Don't go out on the project and say that here the mix looks very coarse, you know, you say no, take sample here. No, that's not the way. You decide in the morning where the locations are. Here is just a mix, the plant is, the sample is being taken in the truck, so you can sample from the truck. In the USA, they have developed this mechanized sampling, you know, because in the truck, if you are taking sample, you cannot reach far up, too far in the truck, you know, it's hot mix, you know. So mostly you end up taking sample near the platform. But with this kind of a robot type of sampling, you know, you can take more samples and far away from the platform. You can also take sample behind the paver. Some agencies in the US, they said, I don't care what comes in the truck, you know. I don't want any segregation on the project. I want what mix is going on the road, that's what I'm concerned about. What comes in the truck, I don't care. I want to take sample behind the paver. So these guys are taking, you know, loose mix behind the paver. Yeah. And then you can split the sample. There are splitters available when the mix is hot and loose. You can split the sample. If you are in the quality assurance, you can give half the sample to the contractor. So he can compare the results with you. He cannot question your results, you know, because that half sample is with him. He can test if he wants to, or you can retain the sample for future reference. So once I get the sample, I find the bitumen content in the laboratory air voids, marsh specimen, field air voids in compacted net. Now, okay, I think I'll ask that question in the end. So bitumen content of 5 sublots, let's say here is an example. I have 1 day's production and I got 5 sublots and my design is 6.1, and let's say I'm allowing 0.4. MORT is allowed 0.3, let's say I am allowing 0.4, so the range of 5.7 to 6.5 is acceptable. So I got these 5 results, 6.0, 5.6, 6.2, 5.8, 6.1, I got these 5 results. I can see that second result 5.6 is out on the low side, all the other 4 meet that. What does it mean? What I make out of these 5 numbers? Do I penalize the contractor because 1 result was out? Did I just tell him that, you know, remove all the project, I don't accept it? Or do I let it go? how do I make a judgment? I don't think, you ask anybody, somebody will say, no, it's, one sample is bad, 20% of the job is bad, so you remove. Somebody will say, 20% is okay, one sample bad. I will get, you ask 10 people, they will have 10 different opinion. How to judge the quality of that one lot? So that's where, you know, we have to come deal with the statistics, you know. We have to, it's a tool for helping to make informed decision and resolve disputes. Now this is being done in the US right now. Most states have adopted that, you know. They don't just go by gut feeling that do mein se panch mein do mix result fail ho gaya to pura kharab hai. So they don't go by that. So how do we do that? If we tool these use these tools, there's a software available. We don't have to do too much of that. These tools will measure the variability of the that day's production by measuring the standard deviation of those five result I got. I'll take the mean and standard deviation of those. So standard deviation tell me about the variability, how good was the process control of the contractor. Also, I will calculate the percent within limits. How much of that project or job and that day's production, how much percentage of that job met my specification limit of plus minus 0.4 in this case. Or you can have air void or anything, you know. So percent within limits of the specification, PWL, I can calculate that. And based upon that, I can have a pay factor. If your percent of the within limit is so much, I pay you 80%. If it's so much, if it's more than 100%, I pay you bonus. So there is no personal judgment involved in that. I got those five numbers, and the software will tell me about all these things, you know. And my subcontractor has to understand that all, that this is what will happen. Then the lastly, the comparison of data group. Supposing I get five binder content, and the contractor runs those tests five split sample, he get five different numbers, they are not going to be identical. So there is should be way that are his number similar to my number. Statistically, is there any significant difference or not? Those number might be different, look different, but they might be coming from the same population. So for that, we have, once I get those five samples, five data point on binder content, I have a normal distribution curve. That's always, you know, they're always like that. And then I have within one standard deviation, S is for standard deviation, plus minus one standard deviation will cover 68% of the project, plus minus two will cover 96% of the project, plus minus three standard deviation will cover almost 100% of the project. So this normal distribution curve will always happen when you have five samples or six samples. All you are doing is feeding in the sample number, those five binder content, and you are saying there are five numbers of samples, and the software will plot this normal distribution curve. I'm sure you studied that in your civil engineering. So now our job is to find the percent within limits. I got that normal distribution curve. So here I have two contactors, and here is the measurement of density, like in place density. I got 92% is my requirement of the theoretical. So everything has to be on the right side. Number of samples. So I got contractor A, well, let's not say contractor A, let's say lot number 1, lot number 2. This normal distribution curve is came from lot number 1, which had 5 points of density. This one came from lot number 2, also has 5 density sample. So this one has an average of mean of 93.5% of standard deviation is 0.75. This one has a 96%, this one has 2.0. Now both of them meet the minimum of 92%, right? But what's the difference here? What difference you see in lot number 1 and lot number 2?
Variation is very small.
Yeah. Very good.
Variation is very high.
It's very high. The comment here is that in lot number 1, which is white, you know, standard deviation is low, so variation is very low. This contractor, let's say contractor A and B, this contractor really did a very good compaction job, you know, very uniform rolling pattern, everything he maintained real good, you know, hot mix and everything. Whereas the contractor number B, it met the specification, you know, but he doesn't have good control on that. You know, sometimes you get a very high density, sometimes you get lower density, which is not a good thing. Although both will meet the specification, so you can get a picture of these two quality, although both meet the 92%, you know. So it's really a good tool to. Now this contact number B has to really improve his way of construction, you know. So now the PWL concept and PD contact concept comes here like this way. Here we have bitumen content here, and let's say I got 5 test results on bitumen content, and I plot my normal distribution curve here based upon that. Now let's say here is my target, you know, so the target is okay, then plus minus 0.3, these are the lines. I will allow plus minus 0.3, you know. Now anything falling here is the PD percent defective on the high side, too much bitumen on the low side. You got too much bitumen on the high side, too less bitumen on the low side. So PWL is the white area in between, and both side I have PD percent defective on the low side, percent defective on the upper side, which is PDU. So how do I find the PWL? PWL will be like 100 minus PDU and plus PDL. That will be, so I percent defective I subtract from 100, then this will be under the percent within limits. So that kind of gives some idea, you know, what is percent within limits. You have to have a normal distribution curve, you have to have your upper limit or lower limit, and the computer will tell you. Once you feed in those numbers, computer will automatically draw the normal distribution curve and tell you what the PWL is, how much of that day's production was within limits.
Very few numbers like 5 and less than 5,
Will
normal distribution can be applicable?
Yeah, up to like 4 and 5 it will be applicable. Sometimes like when you have only 3 samples, like you have one lot, you know, when next day your job is going to finish, so you got like 2 or 3 number, then there are other ways, either you combine those 2 or 3 number with the previous day. So there are many things to take care of that. So previous day you had 5 numbers, next day your job finished, you had only 2 sublots, you cannot analyze 2 sublots as you said, you know, you cannot draw any normal distribution. So combine those 2 with the previous one, so you got 7 samples. So these are built-in conditions, you know, to take care of these kind of things. So here we have percent with the limit for bitumen content, and again we can see here lot number 1 and lot number 2. Lot number 1 is this one here, the target is 5.0 and it goes here and plus minus 0.4, so the lot number 1 is really good, right? There is no defective because the target upper limit is here and normal distribution curve start from here and here. Lot number 2 had the same average, the same bitumen content, but it has a defective material on both sides. So it's a PWL of lot number 1 is 100%, PWL of lot number 2 is 67%, although they both hit the average is same, both of them. So this graph really shows you that percent within limits, you know, and it's all done by the computer software. Now here again, here we have different averages. This contractor is running low on the bitumen content, lot number 2. Lot number 1 is right on the target, so lot number 2 has some defective on this side, on the low side. So payment is based upon PWL. We calculate the percent within limit, which computer will do it. Small number of test results outside the specification limits is normal and not necessarily detrimental to performance. Your one bitumen content is out. Don't worry about that as long as you know your analysis shows that the person within limits is okay. Payment is based upon PWN and allows for both potential penalty to or bonus. Commonly requires 90% PWL for full payment. You know, we can never be perfect. We can never be achieve 100% person within limits. That is nature, law of the nature, you know. So as long as the contractor give us 90% person within limits, I'll pay him 100%. I mean, that's the way the things are, you know. If it is more than 90%, then I'll give him bonus. If it's less than 90%, then the payment will be reduced. And these are the kind of tables highway agencies have in the US. They have somewhat different table for each highway. Again, if the person with the limit is 96 to 100, then the contractor will get paid 105%. So he's getting a 5% bonus. If it's 90 to 95, then person with the limits plus 10%. In other words, if you got like 93% person with the limit, so 93 plus 10 will be 103. You still get some bonus, you know, and so forth. And if it's below 60 PWL, you reject it. That's too low, you know, we cannot accept that. That will be like remove and replace.
This is being strictly followed in the in US?
In the US, yeah. Most states have gone to PWL. Or some other concepts which are simpler than PWL, but
okay, but there is a performance based payment.
Yeah, yeah. And they go from lot to lot. Like one day the contractor's work might be bad, you know. Why should I penalize him for like 20 days production, you know. So one day his production is bad or whatever, he get penalized for that. Next day he's got a good performance, you know. So why should he penalize for that, you know. So there is a both for the risk for the owner and the contractor is minimized by going with the lot system. You are paying based upon lots. So this kind of thing can be developed by L&T and ask the subcontractor that look here, that's what we are going to pay for, you know.
In that case, who will be handling the laboratory, the client or contractor?
Now, when you do a quality assurance, then you have to have an independent agency to do that. Now, there are some states, you know, which are very, they also accept the contractor results to make the payment as well. So there are some states in the US, they don't have any independent testing. There are some agencies do their own testing, like in Pennsylvania where I worked, I was doing my own testing. Sample will come to the central lab and we do the testing. But then there are some do with independent. Now, how do we enforce it in India? I don't have any idea. One is that if L&T is subcontractor, then L&T is the owner, because you want a good quality work, you know, and you tell your subcontractor, this is what I am going to pay you. NHI might have independent consultant, but then they have to have a lab.
No, that and all is not there. Independent engineer is not having a lab. In our practice, only contractor is having lab. All other parties will witness the contractor
lab. Yeah, okay. Now the last point here we have the what if the contractor dispute agency test results, like retesting is conducted, and when we do the retesting, original testing has these results 6.0, 5.6, 6.2, 5.8, 6.1. When the retesting is done, even by the same agency, the results can vary, you know, because you have this sampling and testing error. So you can have these results 6.1, 5.2. Now, we have to determine the are they both okay? Are they comparable? Is there any significant difference between these two or not? It will depend upon the analysis. So we have to find the mean and standard deviation of both lots, conduct a t-test to determine if the two tests of the results come from the same population. Sometimes you will find out by doing the analysis, although the numbers look different, they are both, there is no statistical difference between these two, they both are acceptable. Now, we cannot make any judgment with just by taking the mean out. The computer has to do these things. We cannot make any judgment. I got five numbers. That's what they do. Sometimes CRI does, you know, when they compare CRMB with VG30. After 1 or 2 years, they take, you know, some dense results, you know, and they say, and they just take mean only. They say this mean was higher for CRMB, the mean was higher than, they draw a conclusion, but that doesn't mean that they are both different. So what we have in India is, we have a bhed chal. Jo chal raha hai wo theek hai, wo ek sample leo wo theek hai, usko, if it doesn't pass, you know, then take one more sample, take judgment on that and all that, you know. So here we have a lot of sheep, you know, blocking the exit of the expressway, but they will take their own time, you know, and we'll follow the bhed chal. So unless we have QC, QA, you know, is we won't have good roads like that. So QC, QA is the, now the time has come to introduce QC, QA in India actually. Now who will do it? I don't have an idea. I don't think MRTH is
necessity
going to do
it. Necessity is mother of invention.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, if we are willing to hit it, then we will take care of it.
If there are any questions on QC, QA.
Yeah, sir. Mutti sir, apka favorite area.
Hello?
Yeah, please.
Sir, actually one small doubt in there, sir.
Sure.
Regarding the extraction of binder content by centrifugal equipment.
Okay.
Actually, we will take around 400 grams of sample to represent the binder content, sir.
Okay.
And with that binder content, we will find out the gradation also, sir.
Right.
For 30 ton of mix, this 400 grams of sample, is it a representative and is it give the exact values or is it only the temporary value, sir?
Well, first of all, your sample size should be according to the test method, you know. For each aggregate size you have, like if you have a mix with the half inch, like 12.5 millimeter aggregate, you have a 25 millimeter aggregate. So the ASTM gives you the minimum size of the sample you have to extract. So I don't know whether 400 is there or 500 is there, whatever is there, you have to have that minimum size of the sample for extraction. Is that clear? I'm
talking about. Yes, sir. Actually, okay. I am agreeing with that one. Sir. It
okay.
Upon the gradation.
Okay. Now.
And based on that, the sample size will be there. The maximum is 1 kg only, sir.
Yeah. So that takes care of the size. You know how size, big size the sample should be done. Then you are talking about only one sample, you know. If I take only one sample from the project or from the day's production, that one sample might fail, you know, in extraction. That doesn't mean that it was really a bad mix, you know, because I might have sampled at the wrong place. I might have some testing error. So there are three things will cause your test result effect. One is the natural variability in the material. Second is the sampling error. Third is the testing error. So if any of these things, like sampling has been bad or testing has been bad, the sample might fail. So that's why, you know, it's better to rely on four or five samples to make a judgment. You cannot make any judgment for a project or for one day's production based upon the result of one test. That was the thrust of this whole talk. You agree with that?
Sir, as per the specifications and the frequency of testing also, sir, they are stressing on 400 tons, one test to be done for the extraction.
Yeah. Yeah, can you say it again?
Sir, according to the standards, the frequency to be conducted for the bituminous mixture,
yeah.
They are stressing that to minimum 2 tests per day or 400 tons, 1 test per
day. Right, that's what they say, okay. That's what they are saying, you know, but we are not on the quality assurance as yet, you know. What it says is, it's not the quality control, quality assurance, we just talk about that. What we just talk about that, to judge a quality of a material, you have to divide into lots and sublots. And you have to judge the quality of this lot based upon the results of the sublots. So, whatever the Orange Book says, you know, has nothing to do with what we just discussed, you know. We got to move on from there. That is for the contractor. And the Orange Book says that the contractor shall run extractions at least twice a day, right? Now, that's only for the contractor. Now, how the agency is going to accept that, thing, that's what we discussed just now, you know, that to make that judgment, to accept, we have to have like sublots and five results, so four or five results to make a judgment. So whatever is being asked in the Orange Book has nothing to do with what we just said. You know, it's a new, completely new concept, QC, QA, which has not been implemented in India as yet. We must implement that.
Thank you.
Sir, again, the plus or minus 0.3 for the acceptance criteria, everything is given, the bitumen content. See, work is completed. That is the, whatever they have mentioned is, during the execution of the work, for the acceptance criteria, that limits have been mentioned.
Right.
Work is completed. Now, there was some problems with the particular project. I have taken 10 particular samples to cores, basically. 10 cores randomly at wherever there are failures. Or wherever I have taken 5 samples in good location, I have taken 5 samples in wherever the distresses location. In that case, if I get the bitumen percentage less than the what it was supposed to be, still the limits will it be applicable at that locations also? Let's say, if it was designed for 5.2, but plus or minus 0.3 is allowed, if I get 4.9, is it acceptable?
It won't be acceptable in that quality assurance normal distribution curve. If your all numbers are below, so the normal distribution curve, when you plot that, well, first of all 5 samples cannot be exactly 0.3 below, right?
Correct.
Maybe somebody 0.3, 0.2 below or whatever.
Even if it is...
So if it is below, then the normal distribution curve will go outside the target. And you will have percent defective on the low side. The normal distribution curve will take care of that, you know.
But every time we have to apply a normal distribution, we cannot see it as an isolation.
Yeah. We have to apply the normal distribution curve.
We cannot see it in isolation, and we cannot say that it is acceptable or not acceptable.
Yeah. So if all the results are on the low side, although they are still within the target, the normal distribution curve will plot outside, and you will have some percent defective on the low side. That will take care of it, you know. They will take care of our judgment part, you know. I don't know whether I made it clear. Results are within the tolerance, but normal distribution curve will plot outside. Would be outside low side. Any other question?
Yeah, please continue.
Sir, I have more specified 5 to 6 minor content for grading 1 and grading 2, 5 to 7. And 5 is the lower limit and 6 is the higher limit. So, below 5, is it allowable or not?
Grading 1?
CPBs are told that every time the contractor is almost using 0.3% of grade.
You're talking about the BC grading 1 and 2?
1 is 5 to 6, sir. So the lower limit is 5, so better we have to consider as a minimum 5 or from that also we can go below plus minus 0.3.
You know the way the limits are in the Orange Book, they also have a higher limit on binary content or only the minimum?
No, in acceptance criteria only they mention it is plus or minus 0.3.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Whereas in tables they give the bitumen range as 5 to 6 as is 0.8.
Oh, they give a range, yeah, okay.
So, this exact bitumen of whatever the designed mix is, from that it is plus or minus 0.3, or whatever the tables he has given, from that it is plus or minus.
Okay, 0.3. I understand your question. The answer to that is that when you develop a job mix formula, the binder content in the job mix formula should fall between that range given in the Orange Book. Okay. Now, your job mix formula might be at the boundary of that range. Then you apply plus minus 0.3 to that. It might go out of the
envelope,
doesn't matter. Yeah, ask him, yeah. Understand.
Is it clear? If it goes less
than 0.3, then what sir?
No. What sir is saying that your job mix formula OBC must be in that range first.
First it is in range, my mix is 5.1 now.
Even then also for that 5.1 you have to apply plus or minus 0.3. In certain cases it may go beyond lower limit also.
Yeah.
Still it is acceptable.
Right.
As long as it is within the plus or minus 0.3 of your OB, optimum binder content.
Any other question?